Random House Audio presents Walt Disney, The Triumph of an American Imagination by Neal Gabler. Read for you by Leonardo Leoncavallo. He was frozen. At least, that was the rumor that emerged shortly after his death and quickly became legend. Walt Disney had been cryogenically preserved, hibernating like Snow White and Sleeping Beauty, to await the day when science could revive him and cure his disease. Though it is impossible to determine exactly, the source of the rumor may have been a tabloid named National Spotlight, whose correspondent claimed to have sneaked into St. Joseph's Hospital, where Disney had expired, disguised himself as an orderly, picked the lock on a storage room door, and spotted Disney suspended in a metal cylinder. In truth, Disney's final destination was fire, not ice. He had been cremated and his ashes interred in a mausoleum in a remote corner of the Forest Lawn Cemetery in Glendale, California, not far from his studio. But the endurance of the rumor, however outlandish, testified not only to the identification of Disney with futuristic technology late in his life, but to a public unwillingness to let go of him. Arguably, no single figure so bestrode American popular culture as Walt Disney. By one estimate, in 1966 alone, the year of his death, 240 million people saw a Disney movie. A weekly audience of 100 million watched a Disney television show. 80 million read a Disney book. 50 million listened to Disney records. 80 million bought Disney merchandise. 150 million read a Disney comic strip. 80 million saw a Disney educational film, and nearly 7 million visited Disneyland. But Walt Disney's influence can only be measured by how thoroughly he reshaped the culture and the American consciousness. This book is an attempt to penetrate the image and decipher the mystery of Walt Disney. To understand the psychological, cultural, economic, and social forces that acted upon him and led to his art and his empire. And because Disney was so deeply embedded in the American psyche and scene, understanding him may also enable one to understand the power of popular culture in shaping the national consciousness, the force of possibility and perfectionism as American ideals, the ongoing interplay between commerce and art, and the evolution of the American imagination in the 20th century. In short, to understand Walt Disney, one of the most emblematic of Americans, is to understand much about the country in which he lived and which he so profoundly affected. 1. Escape. Elias Disney was a hard man. He worked hard, lived modestly, and worshipped devoutly. His son would say that he believed in walking a straight and narrow path, and he did, neither smoking nor drinking nor cursing nor carousing. He spoke deliberately, rationing his words, and generally kept his emotions in check, save for his anger, which could erupt violently. He looked hard, too, his body thin and taut, his arms ropey, his blue eyes and copper-colored hair offset by his stern visage, long and gaunt, sunken-cheeked and grim-mouthed. It was a pioneer's weathered face, a no-nonsense face, the face of American Gothic. But it was also a face etched with years of disappointment. Disappointment that would shade and shape the life of his famous son, just as the Disney tenacity, drive, and pride would. In July 1834, Arundel Elias Disney, Elias Disney's grandfather, set out from Ireland for America with his older brother Robert and Robert's wife and their two children. They had intended to settle in America, but Arundel Elias moved to the wilderness of southwestern Ontario, Canada, and bought 149 acres along the Maitland River. In time, Arundel Elias built the area's first grist mill and a sawmill, farmed his land, and fathered 16 children. In 1858, the eldest of them, 25-year-old Keppel, who had come on the boat with his parents, married another Irish immigrant named Mary Richardson, and moved just north to Bluevale in Morris Township, where he bought 100 acres of land and built a small pine cabin. There, his first son, Elias, was born on February 6, 1859. Keppel Disney was not the kind of man inclined to stay on a farm forever. When oil was struck nearby in what came to be known as Oil Springs, Keppel rented out his farm, deposited his family with his wife's sister, and joined a drilling crew. He was gone for 2 years, during which time the company struck no oil. He returned to his farm, only to be off again, this time to drill salt wells. He returned a year later, again without his fortune, built himself a new frame house on his land, and reluctantly resumed farming. Hearing of a gold strike in California, he set out in 1877 with 18-year-old Elias and his second eldest son, Robert. They got only as far as Kansas, when Keppel changed plans and purchased just over 300 acres from the Union Pacific Railroad, which was trying to entice people to settle at division points along the train route it was laying through the state. The area in which the family settled, Ellis County, in the northwestern quadrant of Kansas, about halfway across the state, was frontier and rough. Keppel, tired of the cruel Kansas weather, decided to join a neighbor family on a reconnaissance trip to Lake County, in the middle of Florida, where the neighbors had relatives. Elias went with him. For Elias, Florida held another inducement besides the promise of warm weather and new opportunities. The neighbor family they had accompanied, the Calls, had a 16-year-old daughter named Flora. Keppel returned to Ellis shortly thereafter. Elias stayed on with the Calls. Elias delivered mail from a horse-drawn buckboard and courted Flora. Their marriage at the Calls' home on New Year's Day, 1888, wedded the intrepid determination of the Disneys with the softer, more intellectual temper of the Calls. Marriage, however, didn't change his fortunes. He had bought an orange grove, but a freeze destroyed most of his crop, forcing him back into delivering the mail. In the meantime, Charles Call had an accident while clearing some land of pines, never fully recovered, and died early in 1890. His death loosened the couple's bond to Florida. The Disney wanderlust and the need to escape would send Elias back north, this time to Chicago. He had been preceded to Chicago by Robert Disney, Elias's younger brother, by 2.5 years. 6 months after Elias married Flora, Robert had married a wealthy Boston girl named Margaret Rogers and embarked on his career of speculation in real estate, oil, and even gold mines. He had come to Chicago in 1889 in anticipation of the 1893 Columbian Exposition, which would celebrate the 400th anniversary of Columbus's discovery of America, and had built a hotel there. Elias had also come for the promise of employment from the fair, but his dreams were humbler. Living in his brother's shadow, he was hoping for work not as a magnate, but as a carpenter. The Disneys arrived in Chicago late in the spring of 1890 with their infant son, Herbert, and with Flora pregnant again. Elias rented a one-story frame cottage at 3515 South Vernon on the city's south side, an old mid-19th century farmhouse, now isolated amid much more expensive residences. Construction on the fair began early the next year, after Flora had given birth that December to a second son, Ray. Elias earned only a dollar a day as a carpenter, but he was industrious and frugal, and by the fall he had saved enough to purchase a plot of land for $700 through his brother's real estate connections. By the next year, he had applied for a building permit at 1249 Tripp Avenue to construct a two-story wooden cottage for his family, which the following June would add another son, Roy O. Disney. Using Robert's contacts and leveraging his own house through mortgages, he began designing residences with Flora's help and then building small cottages for working men like himself. By the end of the decade, he and a contractor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.